Hi to everyone and welcome to this Agilent Technologies webinar. Right now I'd like to introduce today's presenter, John Screech. John graduated in 1986 with a bachelor's degree in physics and has worked since 1988 in analytical instrumentation. His career has spanned general mass spectrometry, vacuum system development, and contraband detection. John is currently based in Toronto, Canada, and supports Agilent's AFO sales team as a senior applications engineer. John has lectured at over a dozen universities and national labs in Canada and the U.S. on vacuum technology since joining Agilent in 2011. So, John, welcome to today's event. And with that, I'm going to pass things along to you to get us started. So, John, go right ahead.
Thanks very much and welcome everyone to another presentation in Agilent series on vacuum technology. The title of this one is, of course, what's the best ion pump for my UHP system? And hopefully that's a question that you'll be able to answer yourselves when we get through this presentation and we give you some more explanations of the various interactions of different components or ion pumps of a UHP system. So let's get started. Okay, let's look at what we're going to talk about. We're going to talk about getting to ultra-high vacuum pressures, so the characteristics and some of the gas load sources that we're going to encounter. We're going to touch briefly on system design and operation, then have a quick review of rough and high vacuum pumps. Finally, we're going to get to our UHP pump technologies, including sputter ion pumps, non-evaporative getters, and titanium sublimation pumps. We're going to really do a deep dive on the sputter ion pumps themselves, go back to some of the history since the invention of that pump, and talk about the different physical pumping mechanisms of chemisorption and physisorption of the pump. And then we'll go into the very specific variants, the noble diode pump, and of course the triode or optimized triode being the StarCell design, and what the benefits and features of each of those are, and what some of the trade-offs would be. I'm going to give you a couple of practical examples. We're going to look at an example of a scanning electron microscope and also a large-scale interferometer, the LIGO system at Caltech, that was used in the discovery of gravitational waves, was partially enabled by Agilent's ion pumps. For any of you that have seen my webinars before, you'll be familiar with this graph. It's showing the some of the different applications we see and at what pressures those would occur at. We break the vacuum regime down to basically three areas: rough, high, and ultra-high vacuum. Again, there's no hard and fast rule between what we call high and ultra-high vacuum. And I kind of arbitrarily choose somewhere around 10 to the minus 8 torus being into the UHV range. It's interesting to see that the applications we're talking about here generally are things that are very large and very small. So we're talking about space research and things on the dimension of large-scale particle accelerators and things of that nature, but also the very small. We're looking at electron microscopes as being one of the dominant customer spaces for ion pump technology. Let's talk about how we get to UHV pressures, some gas load sources, some of the pumping technologies available, and a little bit of notes on the architecture of a typical UHV system. Let's look at a little bit of the characteristics of ultra-high vacuum. Of course, we're talking about gases coming off walls and surfaces, so we're really not that concerned with the chamber volume, only in the way that it impacts the internal dimensions or the physical surfaces on the inside of that chamber. So let's get rid of our chamber volume. Also, desorption. Any UHV system is really going to require some sort of baking, which is the best mechanism we have today for driving off as many of those molecules off the surface. And typically, we're talking about water at this point, driving water off surfaces, and we can get to the true, let's say, the true nature of a UHV system. Well, we're talking about the gases in a UHV system. Of course, they're in molecular flow. The mean free path is much greater than the chamber dimensions, meaning the particles are having no interaction with each other and are only interacting with the chamber. They're moving at the speed of sound, typically something like 750 miles an hour. And gases, of course, are moving randomly in all directions and in straight lines. The type of gas we're trying to pump, even down at 10 to minus 9 torr, we still have some water available or coming off surfaces that we're trying to pump away: carbon monoxide, nitrogen, and hydrogen. So a little bit lower, we start to lose the water and the nitrogen. 10 to the minus 10, we're really looking at carbon monoxide and hydrogen. And finally, in a true UHV, almost people are using the term XHV these days, down at 10 to the minus 11 torr and lower, really the only species we have left is hydrogen. And we'll see how that plays into your choice of ion pumps as we get later on in the presentation. I love this curve. The graph shown in green there, or the line shown in green, typically represents the pump down description of every vacuum chamber I've ever worked with in my career. So we have a very quick pump down from atmosphere. We hit the point of desorption somewhere just below about one torr, and then a very slow decay in pressure below that. We look at our sources of gas in a UHV system. So this would be the sources of gas over any vacuum chamber. But I think in a UHV system, we can realistically eliminate a significant number of these. We're not going to have any real process gas. We're going to assume that we've solved or addressed the number of real leaks in the vacuum system, typically using something like a helium aspect leak detector, such as Agilent's new HLD detector, to locate and fix most of the physical leaks in the chamber. Virtual leaks is something that we will have addressed or located and identified using techniques such as our leak up rates and things like that in the vacuum chamber. So let's assume that we've got rid of most of those. And really, again, we're down to a few, a very small number of vacuum sources, that being the diffusion of gas molecules from any components we have inside the vacuum chamber and permeation through the walls of that chamber itself. UHV systems, we need to consider one more source. If we have a high vacuum pump, such as the turbo pump shown here, we have to be aware that at some point that pump will hit its compression limit, and we're going to start to see what I'm calling here is backstreaming, but not in the sense of oil molecules, but this is gas molecules moving from the foreline back through the drag stage of the turbo, through the blades, and into the chamber. What we really think about here is that even though that turbo pump is still operating at full speed, we've hit the point of equilibrium where a gas molecule is equally likely to migrate backwards from the foreline into the chamber as it is to go from the chamber into the through the turbo pump and into the foreline. So I won't go into great detail about our different pumping techniques. Suffice to say that every UHV system is also a rough vacuum and a high vacuum system, so we can't escape this. Talking a little bit about some of the techniques we have available. And again, I'll just touch on these because there's additional material on the web, particularly in the Agilent series of webinars available to cover this topic. In rough vacuum, some choices would be diaphragm, oil-sealed rotary vane, and oil-free scroll pumps. UHV systems, we're going to say that the diaphragm pumps really don't get to a low enough pressure to be a big factor and don't typically have a large enough capacity. So we'll take them away. Oil-sealed rotary vane pumps, again, the oil becomes problematic. So the dominant choice, I would say, for UHV systems would be the oil-free scroll pump, an example of which you can see here, the Agilent IDP7 and IDP10 pumps. And of course, the hypnotic oil-free scroll graphic will tell you to call your sales engineer and purchase some of those pumps right away. Similarly, in high vacuum, we have diffusion pumps, turbo pumps, and cryo pumps available to us. And diffusion pumps are becoming less common in UHV systems because of that potential for the hydrocarbon oil to back migrate into the system. And we'll see the effect, the negative effect of hydrocarbons when we talk, get into detail about our ion pump technology. So again, the dominant technologies are going to be the turbomolecular pump to get through the mid-vacuum region, and of course the cryo pump, which does straddle a boundary between a high vacuum pump and a UHV pump. Let's have a quick look at a typical UHV system. I'm going to talk a little bit about design and some of the elements of this system. So the one of the common things, and we go through this in some detail in the vacuum class that I teach, is whether or not this bypass line is necessary. So you see here we have a roughing valve and a four-line valve, and the ability to rough out the chamber using our oil-free scroll pump directly before we switch over to our high vacuum pumping using our turbo pump. And the dominant factors seem to be the volume of the chamber and how long it's going to take for the turbo pump to spin up, and how long it will spend working against a gas load at or near its maximum tolerable four line pressure. So one of the first decisions is, do we or do we not need that bypass valve? UHV systems, we're going to try and eliminate as many of these components as we can, because each one of those would be a potential source for leaks. We talked about pressure measurement and gauging. We're here, this chamber shown using a little cartoon of the nude hot ion gauge, which would be inserted directly into the chamber. Again, we don't want to have any elbows. We don't want to have O-rings and things like that. So our gauging choices are really down to the hot ionization gauge or the inverted magnetron style gauge using for measuring our high vacuum pressure. We'll talk a little bit later about how we can also use the ion pump current itself once the ion pump has been engaged to measure that pressure. Cleaning and surface treatment, I could write a whole book on this subject. But again, we won't have time to go into the details of that in this talk. Personally, I find that the best sources for information on surface treatments and cleaning of parts for HV and UHV systems, the two dominant sites I would look at would be the CERN site, that's CERN, the Large Particle Accelerator in Europe, but also the NASA site goes into some detail and has some excellent reference papers on that subject. When we're operating the system, we need to think about, again, bakeout time and temperature. It's important to consider that the effectiveness of baking out a system would be linear with the time, so twice as long is twice as effective, but is exponential with temperature. So if I do have the ability, and I'm not saying it's trivial, to double the temperature I'm baking out, I will effectively have four times as effective a bakeout. So a four times greater chance of removing those typically water molecules off the inner surfaces of that vacuum chamber. One of the most common questions we get when discussing HV systems or UHV systems is when to valve out the turbo. And I'll give you an example. There's a vacuum system we had operating in our factory in Lexington, Massachusetts. I was down there teaching a vacuum class and borrowed, if you picture this system the way it's depicted here, I borrowed the high vacuum turbo pump, left all the valves closed, of course, so that the ion pump could still pump on the vacuum chamber. At the end of the class, I returned the turbo pump to its place in the vacuum system, roughed out the turbo using the scroll pump, and then engaged the turbo or high vacuum valve to allow the turbo pump to assist the vacuum chamber. And I shouldn't be, but I was surprised to see that the vacuum pressure in the chamber actually went up. So at that point, my turbo pump itself was not helping me pump the chamber, but was actually becoming a source of gas molecules into the vacuum system. So of course, it made sense at that point to valve out the turbo pump and allow the ion pump to do its job of pumping down. And this was even at the pressures of low 10 to the minus 7 torr. So barely into what we would call the UHV range. When we talk about our UHV pumps, of course, the focus of this talk is going to be on sputter ion pumps. And I will touch a little bit on TSPs and non-evaporative getter pumps as well. But the dominant part of this talk is going to be, of course, how we get to UHV pressures using sputter ion pumps. In fact, the invention of sputter ion pumps was referred to as the invention that made UHV possible. So let's talk a little bit about the history of sputter ion pumps from their first invention. As I say, we'll talk about the mechanism, so what physically happens when we're pumping molecules, and then go into details of the different variants of the sputter ion pump. This slide gives you some of the early history of the development of the ion pump. It was formerly Varian, of course, acquired by Agilent in 2010, all the way back to the very early days. Varian Associates actually founded in 1948 in Silicon Valley in California. Instead of photograph, we can see a very early depiction of the one of the first ion pump prototypes, shown here with also Varian's triode ion gauge for measuring pressure as well. Through the 60s, with the first triode pump was invented to try and overcome this argon instability problem. was first called the Noble Ion Pump and then renamed as the Triode in 79. In 1967, the Italian factory was opened in Torino, Italy, and its main function was to produce ion pumps for the CERN large accelerator in Geneva. Somewhat more recently, the StarCell design is still one of the most significant innovations in ion pump technology. It was invented way back in 1983, and we're going to talk in some detail about how that works and what some of the benefits are. It's important to note, and I know it's not directly related to ion pumps, but the invention of the turbomolecular pump and the common usage in vacuum systems of the turbomolecular pump really changed or had a big impact in the development of ion pump technology as well. The reason being that in the early days of UHV systems, customers were trying to get systems that could have a rough vacuum pump. This would be a dual stage rotary vane pump, dual stage scroll pump, something on that in that realm, able to get down to maybe into 10 to the minus 4 torr, and then trying to start ion pumps at that pressure and have them be able to sustain, create a plasma discharge, and keep pumping all the way down to 10 to the minus 10 or 10 to the minus 11 torr. That's quite a task to ask for. And a lot of the development in the early days of ion pumps was to try and allow them to create and maintain pumping at those high pressures. With turbopumps now being ubiquitous on high and ultra-high vacuum systems, that need has really gone away. And a lot of the efforts to try and make ion pumps work at high pressures have really gone away. It's sort of realized that a better alternative would be to use a turbopump through our high vacuum pumping, something like 10 to the minus 2, all the way down to 10 to the minus 6, 10 to the minus 8, or somewhere in that range, and then have that switch over to ion pumps, which are really the only thing will get you down to those lower pressures needed for UHV systems. We tend to discard sometimes discussions about the electronics to support ion pumps. However, there was some significant advantages in the 90s. The first modern microprocessor controller was created as the multivac by Varian, superseded by the dual controllers, and finally the 4 UHV and IPC mini in the 2000s and 2010s. It's important to note in the 1990s that we started with the integration of titanium sublimation pumps and non-evaporative getters into ion pumps. We'll talk about that in detail, as that's one of the trends we see for the future, is that combination of different pumping technologies and different pumping mechanisms inside a single housing is really going to help drive us to get to lower pressures. One of the questions we're often asked is, how low a pressure can we reach? And there's pressures recorded in literature down around 10 to the minus 12 torr. And one of our main problems of getting to lower pressures is not so much the ability to generate those lower pressures, but how do we actually measure it? There are so few ions around that it's very difficult to get an accurate measurement of what the pressure would be inside the vacuum vessel. Again, into the 2000s, so this is just going up to the point in 2010 where the Varian company was acquired by Agilent, but through the 2000s was a specific diode pump for the scanning electron microscope market, and this is shown here as the SEM diode pump with its unique structure. And really why it was used for electron microscopes, I'll talk about a little bit later. Again, electronics innovations with the 4 UHV and IPC mini. And there's a fair bit of work that's gone on since the acquisition of Varian by Agilent. And again, we'll talk about that as some of the future developments and some of the evolution of sputter ion pumps a little bit later. Okay, that's enough of the ancient history. Let's talk about how these things actually work. We have a little cartoon here of a single cell diode pump element with two titanium cathodes and a single stainless steel anode, typically around 1 inch or 25 millimeters in diameter. We're not showing the magnetic field, which typically runs along the axis of that central cylinder here. And the mechanism here is that we create and sustain a discharge or a plasma inside that cylinder. So you can see that the electric and magnetic fields would combine to create a plasma, which is a collection of ions and free electrons, very tightly bounded by those external plates around that cylinder. We're accelerating electrons that are as part of that plasma by a 1 to 2 kilogauss magnetic field. Again, that's not shown here. And ideally, that's parallel to the anode axis. We'll talk about the importance of that in a couple of slides. Once we create ions, they're no longer influenced by the magnetic field and purely have electrostatic attraction, drawing the positive ions towards those plates at the outside of that stainless steel anode. Okay, so once that happens, the next step really depends on what kind of ions we've created. So we have one pumping mechanism is what's called gettering at the anode surface. And what's happening is that as those heavy ions are being drawn into the or attracted to that titanium plate, they're smashing into that plate and creating a sputtering effect. So they're pulling off what I call fresh titanium, meaning unoxidized titanium, which sputters out and deposits onto that stainless steel anode. Now, that titanium actually forms a very active surface, so that neutral gas molecules landing on that surface will form stable compounds and react. So anything that's getterable or reactive will be pumped away through the formation of stable compounds on the interior of that anode surface. So we're talking about titanium oxide, titanium nitride, and to a certain degree, titanium hydride. Now, those gases, once they've bonded chemically onto the surface, are effectively permanently removed from the vacuum system, so have been permanently pumped away. Again, ion pumps are entrapment or capture pumps, so they're grabbing molecules and holding onto them and preventing them from getting back into the vacuum chamber. So we'll see that there's no roughing pump component, there's no extracting of the molecules from the vacuum chamber. We're simply trapping and holding onto molecules that find their way inside the body of the ion pump here. When we look at lighter molecules, talking about really hydrogen and helium here, as those are ionized and drawn towards the cathode surfaces, they're diffused into the bulk material of the cathode. So titanium particularly has a high affinity for hydrogen, so the hydrogen molecules will penetrate through the lattice structure of the titanium and be permanently trapped inside there. We have a similar effect with helium. However, helium is not permanently trapped inside there and can be re-emitted, and that effect is accelerated by temperature. And it's been said that any ion pump that has pumped a significant amount of helium will continue to emit that over the lifetime of the pump. So once it's seen the large amount of helium, you will continue to see residual helium be re-emitted from those titanium cathodes over the life of the pump. Our next consideration is, what do we do with noble gases? So even though we can ionize them and drive them towards the surfaces, and they will create a sputtering effect, they're somewhat immune to the attraction of that unoxidized titanium. So they don't have any reactions with the surface, so we lose that ability to create those stable compounds. We have a slight penetrating effect where those are driven into the bulk material. However, unfortunately, they don't penetrate very deeply into the bulk material. So as we sputter away titanium from there, continue to sputter away titanium from that surface, we end up releasing molecules that are only lightly buried inside the surface. What we're hoping for with those noble gases is that we get them to reflect off the surface from having incidental angle collisions. And when they reflect as high energy neutrals, what we're hoping is that even though they're not attracted to the unoxidized titanium on the inside of the stainless steel anode, they will land on the surface and will penetrate to a certain degree that unoxidized titanium. And if we can maintain the sputtering effect going, we can actually kind of coat over them with new titanium as it's being sputtered, kind of the equivalent of sort of wallpapering over the dirt on a wall of your house. This is a similar sort of cartoon. We'll go into some detail and show you exactly what these look like in PowerPoint, give you a visual analogy of what we just talked about. Again, for references here, you just can't beat the CERN site. And this is a paper discussing the various mechanisms of sputter ion pump and how they work. Let's look at the cross section there of that little diode pump. We have the negatively charged cathodes here shown. This would be a true diode pump. And our positively charged cylinder, I've cut that away so it really just looks like two bars there, but you can picture a circular anode there in the center. And we have the magnetic field ideally perfectly aligned with the central axis of that cylinder. Our free electrons in the magnetic field are accelerated. They'll travel in extended circular paths until they strike a background gas molecule. What happens next depends on what kind of ions we actually create. We've got positive ions, and those are going to be immune to the magnetic field now, so we're going to take that away. And now we have electrostatic attraction towards that high potential negative plate. So the high difference causes them to accelerate towards the outer titanium cathodes. Let's look specifically what happens with our lighter ions, particularly hydrogen and helium. And as those are accelerated towards the cathodes, they will actually diffuse into the bulk material. Larger molecules, as I said, are driven into the surface, will create a sputtering effect where we have titanium released. And again, it's important to note here that bulk titanium that we have sitting around doesn't have this active component because it's completely covered with an oxide layer. So the minute we have sort of fresh or unoxidized titanium, any oxygen molecules will bond to that surface almost immediately and form an oxide layer. So while that makes a piece of titanium in atmosphere non-reactive, it does help us in this case in a vacuum environment to turn the unoxidized titanium into a very effective pump for oxygen. We can see here that even though my cartoon is exaggerating the amount of erosion of the cathode material, we can see here that it is a true effect. And we can see both on the left, we can see the depth penetration of the erosion inside the titanium surface. And on the right, you can see a couple of things. We'll see at the center of each of those cylinders, you can see the pitting that's shown in detail on the left. But also we can see kind of a plasma etching or plasma cleaning of that surface as we're removing that oxidized layer through continuous sputtering on that surface. Getterable gas molecules are gas species that will react with sputtered titanium. So once these hit the surface, they will dissociate and form stable compounds. And I'm showing hydrogen here as bonding onto the surface, although this is only a small percentage of how hydrogen is pumped. As we said in one of the first of these sort of cartoonish slides, that the hydrogen molecules, the dominant process for pumping hydrogen is diffusion into the bulk material. Next, let's consider what happens with our noble gases. So these are the non-reactive species at the far right of the periodic table. As ions are created from those noble gases, neon, argon, krypton, and xenon, they will of course be driven as positive ions towards the negatively charged cathode plate. Those ions will then be neutralized as they hit the cathode surface, but are only able to penetrate a small distance to inside the bulk material of the cathode. And that leaves them vulnerable to be re-released as we sputter away material from the cathode surface. Now those neutral molecules now will pass again through the ion cloud in the center of the anode ring, will become re-ionized, and will be driven back towards the cathode surface again, but still will only be able to penetrate a small distance into that surface. And this is what leads to what's known as the argon instability problem. This is quite an old picture of that. but we can see over a time frame of something like hours in this particular case that we'll have a release of neutral gas molecules. Particularly, we're talking about argon, so it is the dominant species of those noble gases, something like 1% in atmosphere. We'll have the argon release as titanium sputtered away around those shallow buried argon ions. They'll be re-released, re-ionized, driven back into the surface. We'll see the pressure decrease as that argon quantity of gas is pumped away. And then, unfortunately, will be re-released as we continue to sputter material away around it. Now, the traditional way of dealing with the argon instability problem is a device known as the noble diode pump. And in this pump, we replace one of the titanium cathodes with a heavier material, typically tantalum. And the way this functions is that instead of being even lightly buried in the tantalum surface, the noble gas ions will hit that surface and will be reflected off as high energy neutrals. And the way this would work is that those still won't have enough energy to penetrate into the cathode material. However, they will have enough to penetrate that film of titanium along the anode surface. And by doing this, we can effectively trap them in that surface since there's no sputtering occurring at the anode. So what do I like about this design? It does effectively delay the onset of the argon instability problem. So instead of something appearing over, let's say, an hours or a minute time frame, we can have that that effect being delayed for days or perhaps even months. The downsides of the noble diode design is that simply by having only half as much titanium available, we have less titanium available for sputtering. So we don't have as much material as we did in the standard diode pump to be able to create that film of unoxidized titanium around the inside of the anode ring. Secondly, or similarly, since we don't have that bulk material available for hydrogen and helium to diffuse into, we have a slight decrease in the pumping speeds for helium and hydrogen. This slide is showing the next evolution of the ion pump design. This is on the left, we have the classic triode design where the titanium cathode consists of strips of titanium and an axis perpendicular to the cells of the, or the anode cells of the anode array. We have some advantages here that we have a reduction in the argon instability problem. However, that one of the downsides is in the early days we had the potential for complete erosion of the titanium strips causing a potential electrical short. And that particularly occurred at the ones at the center of those anode rings and was typically a fault of starting ion pumps at high pressures. The next evolution is the StarCell. This was done back in the 1980s, where we have a high potential, high negative potential cathodes, and they have star-shaped cutouts in them that are folded down. That gives us an increased surface area of titanium for sputtering and gives us more stable pumping for argon. One of the things that we've actually seen with this is that now there's imitations that have popped up. There's somebody using a design that's maybe called a spiral cell design. And I've seen that looking through the literature. All right, let's talk about some of the advantages of the star cell design. We have the maximum pumping and longer stability for noble gases. We do this by having those glancing collisions along those folded down flaps of titanium. And what that does is that gives us a sputtering effect that we like, but without having the unburying of lightly buried noble gases. So we get an improvement in our stability for noble gas pumping. We get an overall speed improvement because we're taking advantage of this open structure and having titanium that's being sputtered off the surface being deposited not just on the interior surface of the anodes, but also on the interior walls of the pump itself. So we get a third surface with much larger surface area as a place for gas molecules to land. And our reflective neutrals and even our noble gases will land on those surfaces because we're continually sputtering. We can actually kind of wallpaper over them, as I described a little bit earlier. We get an optimized lifetime, 80,000 hours versus 50,000 hours for the noble diode. And finally, we get increased hydrogen pumping versus the noble diode. And this is simply because now we have two titanium plates, and we take advantage of that capacity of titanium to absorb diffused hydrogen into the bulk material. Let's take a minute and talk quickly about our power supplies. These are very precise power supplies, and they provide the high voltage that creates and sustains the plasma discharge inside those anode cylinders. Agilent has a feature called the step function, in which case we ramp up to the highest voltage available, typically 7 kilovolts, and that gives us the best chance for starting and sustaining the plasma. But once we have the plasma lit, we can actually reduce that voltage down to 5 or even as low as 3 kilovolts. And the reason we do that is the lower the voltage we have, then the more accurate or the less noisy current we can read. And that current between the anode and the cathode, if you remember our talk on the cold cathode ion gauge and how that worked, can actually give us a great measurement of the pressure inside the pump. So we can take advantage of the current reading, translate that to be directly proportional to the density of gas molecules inside, but we have an issue with related to the leakage current. So the current we're actually going to measure is going to be not just the current created by those ion discharges, but also from the leakage of the cables and feed-throughs and other components in the system. And that step feature that allows us to drop to lower voltages helps reduce that leakage current and give us a more accurate current reading. And you can see here that we can measure down in the 10 minus 10 or even into the 10 minus 11 millibar or torr range, using the Agilent's latest IPC mini controller there shown at the right. I'm going to touch briefly on the two additional variants that are using similar mechanisms but aren't exactly the same as sputter ion pumps. The first one being the titanium sublimation pump. In this case, what we're taking, you can see the three wavy filaments on the pump shown at the right here. And what we're doing is we're putting a high current through that. And we're sublimating, so we're going directly from the solid phase into a gas phase. And again, we're creating that fresh or unoxidized titanium on the inside of that cooled canister. So that cylinder we see on the picture at the left is inserted into the vacuum chamber. We can cool it ideally with liquid nitrogen, but even room temperature water will have a benefit. By cooling that cylinder, we allow the gas molecules to have a longer residence time on that surface and a better chance for those stable compounds to perform, to create and pumping away through the creation of titanium oxide, titanium nitride, etc. In the center of that picture at left, you'll see what's called an optical baffle, and that's there simply to prevent titanium molecules from going into our process chamber and potentially contaminating the chamber itself. So we want to try and contain the gas cloud of titanium on the inside so that the film will create, and we use that to pump our getterable gases. Non-evaporative getter is a very specific alloy of material, and these are placed onto metal substrates, let's say. They're heated to activate them. And then these are somewhat exotic materials. We see here we're looking at something that's zirconium aluminum or zirconium iron and vanadium, but thin coatings on the surface of a substrate. And once activated, as I said, that becomes a pumping mechanism by having gas molecules land on that surface and form stable compounds. So as I said, the somewhat exotic compounds that we're using here have a similar function to what the titanium is doing on the inside of the TSP or the sputter ion pump. Okay, so that's given you a review of how the sputter ion pump itself works. And let's get to some specific examples. So this would be a sort of a generic example of a scanning electron microscope. So we're actually going to use this device to transport, let's say, semiconductor wafers through the door into the transfer platen into a load lock. We're going to evacuate that down to a certain pressure, seal off the outside of the chamber. move that into our high process chamber where we can do things like, let's say, deposit material onto it or do some etching on the surface, things like that. Again, we've got a larger pump here to maintain the process chamber down. It's something like 10 to the minus 7, 10 to the minus 8 torr, and we allow a little bit of that gas to pump into the column. So our ultimate goal is to get to something like 10 to the minus 10 torr up at the ion gun. So this will be our absolute lowest pressure. And we can see here we're using a standard diode pump because our dominant species at that point will be hydrogen. So we want to have the highest pumping speed for hydrogen. And again, each of the different chambers on this SEM is isolated. So we have the ability to close off regions and to maintain very low pressures of that space. So it's interesting to see here that the StarCell is almost the perfect ion pump for doing that transfer between the high vacuum inside the process chamber, again, 10 to the minus 8 torr, and to getting us to 10 to the minus 10 torr at the ion gun itself, the highest vacuum in this system. One more example of a system using StarCell pumps. This is the device, or one of the devices that was used in the almost, let's say, the global effort to confirm the existence of gravitational waves. So this is a series of intersecting tunnels here, forming a right angle. And if you can see the details, these are something like 3,000 meters long. So each of these arms would be 3 kilometers long. And what we're doing is we're using a light interferometer. So we're having light beams travel the length of those tubes. And what we're trying to do is we're trying to prevent, with the vacuum system here, we're trying to prevent sound waves from interfering with those beams and the components, the mirrors and things inside there that would prevent the measurement of the existence of gravitational waves. To give you a sense of the scale of this system, as I said, it's 3 kilometers long in each of those main axes, which gives us a total volume of something like 10,000 cubic meters. And we're trying to maintain that pressure in that vessel of 10 to the minus 9 torr. So the StarCell was the pump of choice for this particular branch of the gravitational wave effort. It's a chamber made from 304 stainless steel. We know that hydrogen is a component in the manufacturing of stainless steel. So hydrogen, helium, or gases in particular that we want to pump away. And again, the StarCell does the best job at pumping away a wide variety of different gas species. I like the fact that in reading in some of the notes on the LIGO system, that this chamber would take something like 40 days to pump down and then an additional 30 days of bakeout to be able to achieve those pressures of 10 to the minus 9 torr inside something of that size. So quite an impressive feat just getting to those pressures. All right, so let's try and answer the question we started out here. So what's the best ion pump design? I'm afraid, as typical in physics, the answer is going to be, well, that depends. If I look at the standard diode pump, it gives me the highest pumping speed for getterable gases, and it's the best pump for UHV or extreme high vacuum systems where hydrogen is the dominant species. Downside of the diode pump would be, of course, its low pumping speed for noble gases. And that goes hand in hand with the argon instability issue that we've talked about. The first step in trying to improve or overcome that argon instability was the noble diode pump. And here we're talking about improved stability for noble gases. So quite significantly, 10 to 20 times improvement versus the diode pump. However, the trade-off is we get slightly lower speed for the getterable gases than we did. So the noble diode, again, is replacing one of those plates with tantalum. Rather than titanium. We get much lower capacity for hydrogen versus the diode or the StarCell. And generally, we see higher costs in this because of the cost of tantalum. It's not a common material. Finally, the StarCell. We like this because it gives us our best stability for noble gases, so even better than the noble diode pump. So we're getting 50 to 100 times better than a standard diode and 5 to 10 times better than the noble diode pump. We got a 10x improvement versus the noble diode pump for hydrogen. And again, that's a result of a few things. One of them is a larger area of titanium available for sputtering, so we take advantage of that mechanism. But again, the dominant mechanism for hydrogen is going to be diffusion of hydrogen into the bulk material. The more material we have available, then the greater capacity we have to hold on to hydrogen. Again, gives us our hydrogen pumping speed on the same scale as the diode pump, which is significant, and we get a longer lifetime versus the diode or noble diode pump. The one downside is we do have slightly lower pumping speed for nitrogen, carbon monoxide, and carbon dioxide versus the diode pump. And I was curious about that, but if I look at the picture on the far left here at the top, what we'll see is that the length of those cylinders on the inside to accommodate that extra layer, that extra thickness provided by the StarCell design, is we have slightly shorter tubes. So that's the reason that we give up some of our pumping speed for nitrogen, carbon monoxide, and CO2, those getterable gases. So we have slightly less surface area on the inside of each of those cylinders, and that equates to less surface area for titanium to deposit out. Somewhat offset by the fact that we do use the interior walls of the pump itself because of that open cathode design to be able to pump away our getterable gases on the surface of the pump. So finally, we're going to try and put that into some sort of a table here and describe what we believe would be the best pump for your UHV system. Again, it depends what we want to pump. A lot of people in the UHV world are trying to get rid of a particular species of gas. Oxygen is one that a lot of people, I believe, in the semiconductor world want to make sure that they eliminate. But this is what we could do with our ion pumps themselves. However, a little bit of the cheat would be the best combination that we could do would be to add something like a titanium sublimation pump to our StarCell design. And if we picture, let's say we mentally sum those two different scores for each of those TSP and the StarCell, we can get the highest average score for each of those values. So we get the best pumping speed for a wide variety of gases. However, I must say that in a true UHV XHV system, of which honestly most of the customers I see aren't getting to this range, where we really only have hydrogen as the dominant species, in that case, those people would recommend, or we would recommend for those people to use the diode pump. And an example would be that SEM beam gun, where their ultimate pressure was in the 10 to minus 10 range, and there they were using a diode pump for that region. Okay, that's given you a bit of sort of a state of the art, if you will, on ion pump technology. Let's talk about what's been happening recently. One of the most interesting things, and this has to do with, I think, the evolution of the design of ion pumps, is that it's interesting, the peak pumping speed, if you look at this graph here, it's a little bit difficult to read the numbers, but this is showing a peak pumping speed at a pressure of 10 to the minus 6 torr. Well, that's great, but we have lots of other devices that are very effective pumping speed at 10 to the minus 6 torr. So wouldn't it be great if we could move that maximum pumping speed to a much lower pressure? You see here, by the time we get to 10 to the minus 8, 10 to the minus 9 torr, our pumping speed has fallen off significantly in the traditional ion pump. There's some great work done in the early 2010s by the team at Agilent to really understand the mechanisms involved in what kept that maximum pumping speed at higher pressure, or conversely, what caused that roll-off in pump speed as we went to lower pressures. So understanding the relationship between pressure, sputtering, and pumping ability was phenomenal, or was crucial to these experiments. So the net result was came to be the VIP200. So it's a pump recently released by Agilent. And really what they looked at is the alignment and the strength of magnetic field over the largest number of those anode cylinders inside the array. On top of that, they looked at the geometry and the placement of those that array within the magnetic field. And by simply optimizing those parameters, they were able to produce a pump that has its maximum pumping speed at 10 to the minus 8 torr. So that's significant because at the point where a turbo pump is starting to approach its compression limits and starting to become, let's say, more of a hindrance to us than a help, it's great to have our maximum pumping speed at that pressure. So it's a really significant achievement. It's a very interesting paper produced by Paulini, Audi, and Mark Denning. And you can Google that, or we'll see if we can put a reference to it or a link to it at the end of this presentation. Another innovation has been the customization for specific applications. So here we're talking about things like the SEM diode. This is the one that would have been used by that scanning electron microscope customer, but also the ability for the ion pump controllers to be produced, or the ion pumps themselves, with different kinds of feed-throughs. A lot of customers will have different preference for different types of feed-throughs, and it's important that the vacuum manufacturers become flexible in being able to produce products which meet the needs of those customers. It's particularly important if customers want to be able to use, let's say, one company's pumps with another company's controllers, take advantage maybe of some existing infrastructure and things like that in terms of cabling on these large scale installations. The picture in the middle here at the bottom is a custom application. This was for DESI. It's a large particle beam being produced in Europe. And here we can see that the ion pump itself is actually concentric around the beam line. And this has some significant advantages for that customer in terms of reducing the amount of stray magnetic fields, but also optimizing the pumping speed right at the center of that beam line. So getting the vacuum performance where we need it the most to keep that beam line at the lowest possible pressure. And finally, at the far right of your screen, you can see an arrangement that Agilent has with a company called SAES, which is very big in the non-evaporative getter market. And what we've been doing is combining our technologies into a single package. And we can see here that the inlet of the ion pump is to some degree, you can use the word protected, by this non-evaporative getter material. That does two things. It can kind of capture the low-hanging fruit of some of the gases that NEG film is particularly adept at doing, but also helps prevent any particles being re-emitted from the ion pump. We talked about the memory effect for helium. And how that can affect the performance, but that non-evaporative getter on the surface will be able to address some of that issue by taking care of those emitted gases from the pump. Okay, that's a lot of information to pass on, and I know we're close on time here, but hopefully there's time for a couple of questions.
Okay, John, thanks so much for that great presentation. Okay, John, here's your first question. Why is tantalum used in noble diode pumps, and why does hydrogen pumping speed suffer?
Okay, that's a good question. So the choice of tantalum versus some of the other denser materials, I don't know why specifically that was chosen. What I do know is I can answer the second part anyways to say why does it compromise our vacuum performance. So the reason we like something that, like a dense material like tantalum, is it increases the effect of the reflection of high energy neutrals. So that's important to get noble gases to bounce off that high density plate, in this case tantalum, and to embed themselves into the film of titanium that we've created on the anode, where there's no sputtering, so we can have stable pumping there. Why does hydrogen pumping speed suffer? The dominant mechanism for pumping hydrogen, as I've said, is diffusion into the bulk material of the cathodes. And the fact that we have a dense structure in tantalum compromises our ability to do that, as hydrogen is not, it won't readily diffuse into that much more dense tantalum material. And I think back on the slide, we talked about the relative difference in the atomic mass of those tantalum versus titanium. So I hope that addresses that question.
Okay, John, thanks for that answer. Here's another question that came in. what is the contribution of the magnets to the overall performance of sputter ion pumps?
Thanks. That's a great question. So if you'd asked me a few months ago, I probably would have said the main contribution of the magnets was simply to put those electrons in motion inside the plasma and be able to have them strike background gas molecules. But after reading that paper I referenced by Paolini, Audi, and Denning, I have a much greater appreciation for the benefits and what the magnets really do for us. So particularly, it's critical that the strength of the magnetic field and the alignment to the center of those anode cylinders for producing the sputtering effect, right? So the fact that we create a larger number of ions, we get them driven into the surface, gives us the biggest bang for our buck, if you will, in terms of producing the sputtering that gives us our pumping for getterable gases. So as I said, in the previous slide, the significant achievement of moving that peak pumping speed from 10 to the minus 6 down to 10 to the minus 8 millibar is absolutely phenomenal. So that's 100 times lower pressure to get our pumping speed where we need it, mostly based on adjusting of the magnetic field strength and alignment and the positioning of those anode elements inside that. So at this point, I think the contribution of the magnets is something that's really worth studying, and it's an interesting paper to look through, and you'll have a much greater appreciation, as I did, for the impact of magnets on the performance of sputter ion pumps.
Yeah, once again, thanks, John, for that answer. Here's another question. I read about corrosion of ion pump feed-throughs. What is that all about?
Corrosion of ion pump feed-throughs. I did a little bit of, I came across this in the literature, and one of the things that I noticed was it was related to customers that are using ion pumps in high humidity environments, and really wasn't, as the way I understand it, wasn't a downside of the pumps themselves, but was a phenomena of the feed-throughs that the vacuum companies purchase from third-party companies. So I talked in the last slide about the ability to customize, but choose appropriate fittings and connectors on ion pumps based on the customer's desire and customer's needs. And I think this would be sort of an inclusion into this. So as far as I understand it, the corrosion phenomenon was related to a brazing of aluminum components in the feed-throughs themselves, and that switching to a gold brazing allowed a more resistant to corrosion feed through for those ion pump customers in that high humidity environment. It's worth noting that I think the components that had that corrosion were many, many years old, right? So this wasn't a recent phenomena or a new phenomena with the pumps, but something that happened over many years of operation of those ion pumps in a high humidity environment. So the good news, if you want to look at it that way, is that it's an issue that was identified for certain customers that have that need, and there's certainly solutions around that can address that, which would be simply switching to feed-through design that uses gold brazing versus that kind of earlier used aluminum brazing on the feed-throughs themselves.
Okay, John, and with that, we're going to wrap things up right there. John Screech, thanks so much for taking some time to be here with all of us today.
All right. Thanks very much, everyone. I hope you enjoyed and hope you got some use out of this talk, and we'll see you at the next time. Thanks very much. Bye-bye.
And we'd like to say a special thank you to all of our audience members for being part of this webinar event. Take care and have yourselves a great day.